Hello and welcome to TI Precision Labs. If you have designed or consider designing a system with high-speed data, you have probably run into the question of signal integrity and how it can affect signal performance. Eye diagrams can be useful when evaluating, designing, and debugging your system. However, to make full use of these measurements, it is critical to understand how different signal integrity concepts present themselves. In this session, we are going to discuss the impact of insertion loss, inter-symbol interference, jitter, receiver equalization, and transmit pre- and de-emphasis effects on measured eye diagrams. If you're not familiar with eye diagrams and different uses of eye diagrams, please refer to the earlier What is a High-Speed Eye Diagram video. To review, eye diagrams are electrical measurements used to evaluate the signal integrity in many of today's complex systems. Signal integrity is the term used when discussing the quality of a high-speed signal. High-speed signals should maintain a good quality as they propagate through the transmission media and other components located on the path of the transmission media. If signal integrity is of bad quality, it can prevent the transmitted data from being interpreted correctly by the receiver. This can result in your high-speed data link having corrupted data or the high-speed link failing altogether. Lucky for us, eye diagrams can be used to identify key signal integrity concepts that enhance or degrade system-level performance. In this video, we will discuss identifying three main factors of signal integrity degradation: insertion loss, inter-symbol interference, and jitter. Three of the primary ways we combat signal integrity degradation are with signal conditioning techniques such as receiver equalization, preemphasis, and deemphasis. There are many other factors that can contribute to signal integrity degradation, such as signal reflections, duty cycle distortion, and crosstalk. There are also additional signal conditioning techniques that can be used to combat signal integrity degradation, such as clock data recovery and decision feedback equalizers. These topics will be saved for later videos. The first and most fundamental culprit when it comes to signal integrity degradation is insertion loss. Insertion loss refers to the natural frequency-dependent attenuation of signal power as a high-speed signal propagates through transmission media, but is primarily influenced by channel length and the transmission media's material properties. As an example, the graph above shows the frequency response, or the insertion loss profile, of a 4-mil-wide microstrip trace using standard FR4 dielectric PCB material at different lengths. In most cases, the FR4 PCB trace insertion loss profile will appear mostly linear across frequency. However, as the length of the PCB trace increases, the more insertion loss is seen at higher frequencies. Understanding insertion loss and its variations across frequency is important, as it can impact other aspects of signal integrity like inter-symbol interference, or ISI. Inter-symbol interference is the destructive interaction of distorted symbols in the data stream as they propagate through the transmission media. ISI is caused by the variation in the insertion loss profile of the transmission media. All high-speed data is made up of different combinations of bits or symbols. These symbols can have a different combination of ones and zeros, and, if investigated separately, have their own unique frequency content. Each symbol may not be affected by the transmission media in the same way. This effect can cause edges, transitions from high to low or low to high, to affect one another. As an example, take the two graphs on the right. The top graph shows 10 gigabits per second, 8B10B encoded data as measured directly at the transmitter output. The bottom graph shows the impact of inter-symbol interference through an 8-inch PCB trace. Comparing the two graphs, we can see short symbols, like a single 1 or 0 bit, have a peak-to-peak voltage that is attenuated more due to their high-frequency content. Longer symbols, such as a 1100, 111, or 000, have a peak-to-peak voltage that are not attenuated as much due to their lower frequency content. Major attenuation on the shorter symbols affect the edges of the longer symbols, adding timing error from the next symbol from the preceding symbol. The effects of ISI causes a smearing of the bits or symbols in the data stream, and this presents itself in the eye diagram. It is useful to investigate insertion loss and ISI together in the eye diagram due to their strong relationship. We will be comparing the top eye diagram and the bottom eye diagram to identify key differences. The top eye diagram is our baseline and is measured directly at the transmitter output. In this eye, you can see very little jitter in the leading and trailing edges, little to no variation in the VH and VL levels for the different symbols compiled in the eye diagram, a large eye height and eye width, as no attenuation is applied to the eye diagram. Now, looking at the bottom eye, we can decipher key differences when the high-speed signal has some insertion loss and ISI applied. Pause here to see if you can identify those differences. Increased insertion loss and ISI will cause variation in all the symbols that make up the eye. In the bottom eye diagram, some insertion loss has been applied at a particular frequency. This results in a certain amount of ISI throughout the eye diagram, resulting in insertion loss resulting in reduced peak-to-peak voltage or eye amplitude, negatively affecting the trailing edge shape and rise time, variations in VH and VL levels or thicker bands at both DC voltage levels resulting in reduced eye height, increase in total jitter due to ISI, reducing the eye width. Some high-speed scopes can measure the ISI in terms of picoseconds or milliui. This is approximated from the total jitter. We can also increase the amount of insertion loss in ISI to get a more extreme example and make changes more apparent. Another fundamental concept in signal integrity degradation in eye diagrams is jitter or total jitter. In general, jitter is the measure in any deviation from the true periodicity of a digital signal. The total jitter in an eye diagram is the sum of all the deterministic jitter and random jitter. The most common type of jitter that affects eye diagrams is data-dependent jitter. However, all types of jitter can be seen in the eye diagrams. If you are unfamiliar with the different types of jitter, I recommend watching the What is a Signal Conditioner video. Jitter can present itself in many forms. However, we will focus on the most fundamental and most common change to the eye diagram that jitter creates. Again, we will be comparing the top eye diagram and the bottom eye diagram to identify key differences. The top eye diagram is our baseline. It is important to note that this example has very low jitter. However, the measured total jitter is not zero. In this eye, you can see very little jitter in the leading and trailing edges, no variation in the crossover region. Now, looking at the bottom eye diagram, we can decipher key differences when the high-speed signal has an increase in total jitter. Pause here to see if you can identify these differences. Increased total jitter will cause variation in both leading and trailing edges. In this eye diagram, some additional jitter has been added to the signal, resulting in increased variations in the leading and trailing edges of the eye diagram, reducing the eye width. This impact is seen more as the measured TJ approaches 0.5 UI, and a large variation in where the crossover region occurs in time. We can also increase the amount of total jitter and get a more extreme example to make changes more obvious. It is also important to note that even with the large increase of jitter, trailing edge shape and rise time are not affected, and little to no variation in VH and VL levels. Reduced eye height is not impacted. Now that we have discussed some factors that contribute to signal integrity degradation, we will now discuss some ways we can combat them using signal conditioning techniques. The primary tool that we have to combat signal integrity degradation is receiver equalization. As the name implies, receiver equalization works at the receive end of the signal path by selectively boosting the high-frequency data. An equalizer circuit implements a high-pass filter which has a frequency response that, in a perfect world, is exactly opposite to the transmission media's loss profile, resulting in the data having zero attenuation in the targeted frequency band. In this way, equalizers help to compensate for the insertion loss in a channel and also reduce ISI. Receiver equalization is typically programmable or adaptive, allowing for a variety of transmission media to be used in the same design. In the real world, receiver equalization has limits. As frequency increases, the insertion loss profile of the transmission media will overtake the boosting presented by the receiver equalization, and a negative gain will be applied to the signal. It is important that the frequency response of your receiver equalizer has enough bandwidth to compensate for the attenuation at the highest frequency in the high-speed data stream. Comparing the top eye diagram an attenuated eye with no receiver equalization, and the bottom eye diagram, an attenuated eye with some receiver compensation, and identify some key differences. The top eye diagram is measured directly at the receiver input. In this eye, you can see similar effects of insertion loss, ISI, and jitter as compared to our previous examples. The eye opening is greatly reduced, and this can result in bad signal integrity depending on the receiver input requirements. In this case, some bits are affected more by the 8 inches of PCB trace than others. This results in some separation of the edges that comprise the leading and trailing edges of the eye diagram. This is sometimes referred to as double banding. Now look at the bottom eye diagram. We can decipher key differences when the high-speed signal has had some compensation applied via receiver equalization. Pause here to see if you can identify these differences. Increased total jitter will cause variation in both leading and trailing edges. In this eye diagram, some additional jitter has been added to the signal, resulting in an eye opening that sees major improvement after the equalization has been applied. Double banding caused by the attenuation of different symbols is largely eliminated, helping to improve the eye height and eye width. The thickness of the VH and VL bands is reduced. Jitter caused by ISI is partially reduced, but some jitter still remains. This eye has a near ideal amount of compensation to improve the eye as much as possible. Leading edge time is slightly decreased. If we continue to increase the amount of compensation provided by the receiver's equalization, the eye can start to be over-equalized. In the case of receiver equalization, too much of a good thing can become bad. And in this eye, we show this. In this extreme example of over-equalization, we see that double banding reappears as receiver equalization affects higher frequency symbols more than lower frequency symbols. Eye height can actually increase in this state. Over-equalization can unintentionally amplify some lower frequency noise and jitter. This results in a reduced eye width. Thickness of the VH and VL bands increase greatly. It is important to avoid over-equalization by attuning the receiver equalization to the appropriate value in accordance with the transmission media. Another signal conditioning technique that can be used is preemphasis. Preemphasis focuses on applying frequency selective boosting to the data content at the transmit end of the signal path. To compensate for the ISI effect in the transmission media, preemphasis increases the energy in the edges, the high frequency components, relative to the flat portion of the waveform, the lower frequency components. In the waveform above, you can see an example of preemphasis. We can see the original signal in blue and the signal with preemphasis applied in orange. Preemphasis works to boost the high frequency content of the data by boosting the edge transition of the signal above the actual VH level or below the VL level. Ideally, the boost would be canceled out perfectly by the transmission media right at the receiver, so the data receiver sees a regular bit 1 or bit 0. Identifying preemphasis in an eye diagram can be tricky at times. We will be comparing the top eye diagram and the bottom eye diagram to identify key differences. The top eye diagram is our baseline and is measured directly at the transmitter output with no added preemphasis. In this eye, you should note little to no variations in VH and VL levels for the different symbols compiled in the eye diagram, and no variation in the crossover region. Now looking at the bottom eye diagram, we can decipher key differences when the high-speed signal has preemphasis applied. Pause here to see if you can identify these differences. Preemphasis will cause variation in all the symbols that make up the eye. This results in a certain amount of variation in the edges throughout the eye diagram. To identify preemphasis in an eye diagram, you should look for edge transitions above the expected VH level or below the expected VL level, leading edges with a decrease in rise time. Preemphasis typically does not increase jitter or affect the crossover region. We can also increase the amount of preemphasis to get a more extreme example and make changes more apparent. In this case, we can see that if too much preemphasis creates a double banding effect, this could potentially violate IMAS DC high or DC low regions or distort the intended signal frequency content in an unexpected way. Our last signal conditioning technique that we will discuss is Deemphasis. Deemphasis techniques focus on applying frequency-selective attenuation to the data content at the transmit end of the signal path and is the complement to preemphasis. Deemphasis decreases the energy in the flat portion of the waveform relative to the edges. In the waveforms above, you can see an example of deemphasis. Deemphasis attenuates the DC level in symbols containing more than one bit below the VH level or above the VL level. The deemphasis applied here actually helps to improve the signal-to-noise ratio and make the high-frequency content of the signal more prominent to the data receiver. As with preemphasis, identifying deemphasis in an eye diagram can be tricky. We will be comparing the top eye diagram and the bottom eye diagram to identify key differences. The top eye diagram is our baseline and is measured directly at the transmitter output with no added deemphasis. In this eye, you should note little to no variation in VH and VL levels for the different symbols compiled in the eye diagram, and no variation in the crossover region. Now looking at the bottom eye diagram, we can decipher key differences when the high-speed signal has deemphasis applied. Pause here to see if you can identify these differences. Deemphasis will cause variation in all the symbols that make up the eye. This results in a certain amount of variation in the edges throughout the eye diagram. To identify deemphasis in an eye diagram, you should look for edge transitions below the expected VH level or above the expected VL level, leading edges that see a slight increase or no increase in rise time. Deemphasis typically does not increase jitter or affect the crossover region. We can also increase the amount of deemphasis to get a more extreme example and make the changes more apparent. In this case, we can see that if too much deemphasis is added, double banding occurs. This can reduce the measured eye height or distort the intended signal frequency content in an unexpected way. Thanks for watching our session on signal integrity in eye diagrams. To review what we discussed, let's go over a short quiz. Please check all the correct statements. Preemphasis impacts the high-frequency content of a signal. Receiver equalization helps to attenuate signals in a fixed frequency band. Preemphasis and deemphasis are only applied at the transmitter. Deemphasis impacts the low-frequency content of a signal. The correct answer is A and D. Preemphasis impacts the high-frequency content of a signal, and deemphasis impacts the low-frequency content of a signal. Check all the correct statements. Insertion loss is present in all transmission media. Increased total jitter shrinks the measured eye width. ISI will impact all symbols in the data stream in the same way. The correct answers are A and B. Insertion loss is present in all transmission media, and increased total jitter shrinks the measured eye width. True or false? Signal conditioning techniques are important tools to help ensure a good eye diagram. This is true. Signal conditioning techniques are important tools to help ensure a good eye diagram. Please visit the TI E2E community at ti.com for questions and additional information.